Hey guys, and welcome back to Building Habits. In case you're new here, this is a series where I introduce a set of rules you should try and follow in every game you play. The goal is to teach you strong fundamental principles that we will improve upon as we go. This series is my personal take on how to improve in chess, starting from 400 ELO all the way up to 2000 ELO and beyond. I'm gonna choose a series of rules that I have to follow. What you might notice is that you will miss chances to play winning moves. That's okay. The goal here is to focus on the fundamentals, and I'm trying to get you guys to build good habits and play high percentage moves that will help you increase your rating.
First games are always the toughest. So again, e4, e5. Both Basmaniac. E45, okay. I mean, knights, bishops. And the thing about this is he no longer has bishop c4, so seems like he has a bit of a suspicious setup here. Okay. So h6 just to hit that. Okay, I like what he's doing here. The castle. So, basically my next move would be bishop here. That would be my next move. So I would play bishop e6 if this pawn wasn't being hit. So I think I want to just defend this pawn with one of these moves. Queen b3 seems like not a great move, but it does stop bishop e6, which is what I was planning. So I think I should defend that. Something like this maybe makes sense. I often put my bishop here just as a regular move, so I think this makes sense. I mean, simple math appears to check out here. This looks like something free for me, and it's in the center, and my king is castled, so I feel comfortable taking it as well. Okay, so attacking this, and this pawn is still hit, so bishop e6. Doesn't make as much sense. I think queen to e7 covers this pawn. It's also where I'm probably going to put my queen anyway. That makes a lot of sense. And again, this pawn is hit, which is why I'm not playing bishop there. So again, I feel like bishop back here is very logical. I mean, I just played that move. Makes some sense. Matt, it can happen for black, that checkmate, but obviously it's more rare. A lot more rare. Rook over, and let's not only do this because, hey, it's the developing move I wanted to do, but at the same time, we also want to do this because we want to trade pieces. Why do we want to trade pieces? Because if we count the pawns, I have one extra pawn. Okay, it goes e5. Let's take it. Pawn in the center. Does b6 not work? It definitely does. I'm just going off of moves that I've played in other positions. And I often bring this bishop back to this square. So it's a familiar motif for me, which is why I'm choosing it. So bring the rook to the middle. Okay, knight here. We're pinned in many ways at the moment, actually. Of course, there's you know, moves like this to free myself, but I'm going to play this move, which supports it, and maybe I'm going to double my rooks or something. Hey, rook e1. It's a very good move, actually. Very good move. I think it's time for one of these pawns to chuck itself forward. Okay. He takes. Trades are good. Yeah, pins are nasty. He kind of helped me there by playing bishop takes e6, in my opinion. You know, at least I'm able to respond with Rook takes, trade more pieces. Knight there is a good move. So how do we offer more trades? This should really be a key indication of moves. So this one actually happens to be a really strong move. It's gonna force the exchange of queens. However, when you're deciding what to do, and this is nice, when you're deciding what to do, looking for moves that offer trades, like queen b4, for example, they're gonna be very, very good moves normally. So it's kind of a hack. If you're ever stuck for a move, just offer a trade. Like for example, here again, if I'm stuck for a move, I just offer a trade. Rook is a bit passive right now. I think here on an open file would be a lot better. He's gone here. So again, moves that offer trades, like queen here, I think are super, super strong. Like I said, if you're ever stuck for a move and you're up material, you can never really go wrong with moves like this. Knight g4 offers trades as well, yes, but it also loses a piece, right? There's the queen and the knight on that square, so we can't quite do it. He plays a good move. I'm going to put my rook on an open file. I was going to do that anyway. Fortunately, for my friend here, that's a free piece. Unfortunate. Okay, now he's back. He's back with queen e5. But what did we say? We just want to, you know, always be offering those trades. And he takes it. Very surprising stuff. Very surprising. So we're probably going to bring the rook down and our buddies disconnected. Our buddy is gone. He's out of there. That's the thing about queen exchanges. Like, I'm telling you, man, this stuff's OP. As soon as you're up anything, even here, I'm up a pawn, I'm still going for trades. You know, they're not always going to be the best move, but they're often going to be the best move. Right? Very high percentage. And here we end up winning a piece. But like this move, you know, this move. They're just quick moves you can play. And rook to the open file. And then, I mean, he just hung a piece. So this game was like, he hung this piece, and then he hung this piece. But other than that, I didn't really do that much to him. Just waited for him to blunder. Let's keep going. We don't always start with a win, so we'll take it. How about our openings with white? Which opening are we gonna get here? Which opening are we gonna get? Oh, the French, actually. We don't, this will be fun. We don't get to play against the French that much. Okay, e5. 82, you guys remember the opening? We said we were going to go for the Tarrasch now. We haven't played it that much, so I can understand if you need a refresher. We just haven't played against the French that often. Okay. You guys know where the pieces are going to go. C5. Well, we know the game is going to be open. That's for sure. C5, if I take, we can clearly see our king is going to lose its castling privileges. So I'm going to make a developing move. Plus, we have already discussed that if you know, the move C5 happens normally, that we're going to play moves like C3 and knight F3 to support it. We're not going to be taking it in general. So it makes a lot of sense to go knight here. C3 and knight F3 better. I would probably go with the knight. It may end up being the exact same thing soon if he goes knight here, but I would start with a piece instead of a pawn. Okay, and he does go here. Now, taking this knight for no real reason, not something I'm going to be doing. I'm just going to play C3. supporting it once more. Takes, takes. Yeah, d5 is an option too, but okay, it gives me a check. Let's block. I'm just kind of trying to choose the most straightforward way to play. Okay, because this is exactly what we would do, even if he didn't take on e4. So these are the exact same moves. c3, knight there. If he ever gives a check, always block with a bishop. And my next move, well, I want a castle. Definitely, definitely. Passer machine, if you, I mean, this goes for anyone, but if you can play a chess game and, you know, generally speaking, not hang pieces, at a you know, let's say 75% success rate, you just won't be 500. It's just impossible to be 500. If you don't hang pieces and you start to take the pieces that your opponent is hanging, I mean, you will climb from 500 for sure. Okay, castles, gonna do the exact same thing. Yep, we have a big sub battle tomorrow. We do. Okay, we take back the rooks. Where do you guys think the rooks need to go in this game? This has been an important part of level 3, let's say. Where do we want the rooks? I see, for example, I'll address C1 and E1 because I understand it. One of them is an open file and the other one is a semi-open file. The only reason you guys would be wrong to say that is because black's about to attack our pawn and we simply have to defend it. It's just required. So we do need a rook on the D file for a bit of a defensive purpose. So 100% we need one here, and then it's whether or not we're going to put one on C or E files, right? Those are going to be the next things. Honestly, this is a situation where I think they're both valid, right? But whichever one you pick for the D file affects where the other rook goes. Because you can't put this rook here and then say, oh, I want it back on the E file and go here. So I'm going to choose this one for now. I like D and C. I think it makes the most sense. I think it's the most pure habit to have one rook on the open file, no matter what. And then the other rook does have to do a defensive duty here. Why not rook c1, rook c4? I mean, rooks did not defend well laterally. Rooks defend well from, you know, behind things. I think that's a nice simple rule. Open file for one rook, and this one does need to be defensively placed. How did I know when it was time to get the rooks in? Well, I've moved everything else, right? I've moved every other piece. That's always the time when you get the rooks in. Usually it's time to get the rooks in when you move your queen, because then the rooks are actually touching one another. So you can, once you connect the rooks, you can decide where to put them. F5, attacking my bishop. I have a decision here. Obviously queen takes knight is possible, but we've kind of discussed that we don't really want to give up bishop for knight for no reason. So if we do play this, I need to have a reason to back that up. F5, so I have a couple squares. B1 looks really bad. I would never play a move like this because it disconnects the rooks. I was just talking about how, you know, they're connected. If this rook was already here, might consider it. Bishop c2, I have to reckon with the fact that I'm going to lose this pawn, right? And if I play bishop d3, well, I have to reckon with the fact that I'm going to lose the d pawn. So I think because both of these moves lose pawns and this move looks really bad, I think I am going to take the knight. But that's my justification. I'm not doing it for no reason. I'm doing it because I think I'm going to hang a pawn if I don't. Okay, queen there. This should be like literally a move you play in half a second. There it is. Rook to c1, attacking the queen. We were going to put the rook there anyway, so that makes a lot of sense. Queen d5. Again, I have a hanging pawn in a2, but we're going to play h3. My favorite move. My favorite move. Okay, it plays b6. It's a good move. So now we've sort of done everything we need to do. It's time for maybe a few random pawn moves, but what should we be thinking about in this position? You know, a knight jump into the center makes a lot of sense. Doubling on the open file makes a lot of sense, right? Those are some simple plans that I think we can do here. For example, doubling here is what I'm going to go for right now. Rook c7 is a good move, but I'm going to choose a more tame approach for the moment. He does eventually take it. So now that I'm doubled, I'm gonna start sliding in some of the pieces. He goes queen there. What does it actually threaten? It threatens bishop takes knight. So knight into the middle of the board looks fine. We're gonna slide in. Okay, I've got the firepower. Probably want to go in there and let's be careful. What is he threatening? That's right. Queen takes g2. And you guys are wondering maybe why I'm not playing a3. Okay, it's never going to be perfect. I'm going to play f3, kill this diagonal. You're going to hang pawns from time to time. And generally, like, pawns that are far away from the center, I mean, they're important. But if you're playing good fundamental moves in the middle of the board, I'm happy to see that. So rook to c7 looks like a good follow-up move here. He's threatening the pawn. Let's defend it. Am I a little sick? No, I just was streaming for 17 hours yesterday. I lost my voice. A little bit, I think. Like a little like raspy tone to it. Unfortunately, a defensive move. Kind of gross. We don't like defensive moves, but sometimes you got to do what you got to do. I do get asked quite a lot where to get the sweater from. It's just a place in Canada called Urban Planet. I don't know if that's a place they have outside the. Maybe North America. I think they have it in the US. It was literally $20 Canadian. $20. Not Urban Outfitters. Those are different things. Let's guard the pawn. What was the reason for queen e3? Honestly, just a central move. Just a central move, and I needed to make a move, quite simply. So in this position, I would already start doing some pre-moves like this. Literally, like, these are safe pre-moves that are like near my king. You see how far ahead, like on the clock I'm getting? Like I'm just winning. You know what I mean? Like at some point you guys can just make pre-moves that are all close to one another. Those aren't talented pre-moves. Like I'm not even paying attention to what he's doing. But you'll just win the game. Like if you, the guy's 12 seconds, like literally just, you know what I mean? Just run your king in a circle, bring your pieces back, everything right beside one another. You're just gonna flag him. you're gonna flag him. That's how to do it. You don't have to worry here about like, oh, I gotta play good moves. No one's judging you. Just put everything close to one another. The reason I say close to one another and not pre-moving like stuff like this is you never know when he's gonna play g6 and hit your queen. But the way I'm pre-moving, he doesn't really ever have a dirty move that he can play to win my pieces because they're all protecting each other and they're all right beside each other. Okay, e4, right? So e4, e5. Again, I played the exact same opening every time. It's knight f3. You guys know what it is. Not a secret. Okay, although bishop c4 is a great move, I always start with the knights. I've been starting with the knights every single time. So let's continue that. Okay, e3, let's castle, and h3. Why h3? Because we're looking at this move as a possibility. We're going to prevent that. Okay, time to develop this bishop. Can I go there? There? No, no. Then next best thing, bishop here. Okay, he goes back. I like the game we got going right now. So, let's move the queen. Taking this is a possibility, but generally speaking, I want him to take me. So I can take back. When he goes here, I'm going to do the exact same move that he did. There he goes, knight h7. Again, let's stick with the basics here. You know, rook here and the other rook probably going to go to d1. Okay, nothing too crazy. Let's go rook here. Nice tactic by Buddy. I wasn't sure if he was going to find it. That's a good one. So this is a good tactic to know. It's the first time we've seen it in the series for sure. But it's a really good tactic to learn, in my opinion. You'll get a lot of people with this. It, basically, like, queen on f6 is when it happens most of the time. It's like queen f6 and white's queen. Obviously, it works reversed as well. But your opponent's queen is no longer protecting the knight. And you just snap that h3 pawn. So it looks kind of fancy. But you actually do encounter this quite a bit. So there's a few moves I could do here. Knight to d5 looks like a very strong response to bishop there, just because, you know, it does hit the queen. However, bishop h3 is still a good tactic by him. Something we have to watch out for. At the moment, if I take, it looks like the position opens up. So I don't think I want to take. Let's play our knight d5 move. Don't want to open up my king even more. Yeah, he will go queen g6. He's going to threaten checkmate in one. Something we have to defend. Knight h4, knight on the side of the board. Not usually something we do. So I am going to play a move that, I mean, we're not too proud of it. But g3, we're going to have to do it. Got to stop checkmate. We generally want to avoid putting knights on the side of the board. That's what we've been doing this whole series. So we're not going to start now. Queen h5. Looks like a good move. The knight is being attacked. And how do I save this thing? Knight h2, knight h4. In my opinion, both reasonable moves. I'm going to do my best. do my best to showcase what happens after queen e2. Which is the move I'm going to go for. He's attacking my knight. It's pinned. I only have one move. And it's going to be king up. Queen e2 and king up, I'm, you know, barely holding on here, basically. It gives me a check. I have no choice. I only have one square on the entire board. So it's going to be king back. Okay, he takes here. And I would say that this is kind of an important move. But playing knight takes makes a lot of sense because I get to hit his bishop on g4. And the bishop is the one that's pinning me. My opponent comes up with a great move, knight d4. Now, if I take this, bishop takes e2. Well, you know, at least I can get a few guys for the queen there. But otherwise, if I move my queen or something, he's playing knight takes f3. Getting absolutely destroyed. He's playing a good game. But it's based, it makes sense that you're going to have games like this where you get destroyed. Because what did he do? He had bishop h3. That's a tactic we've just never seen before. You know what I mean? So it does make sense that the first time you see some sort of new tactical idea, it's probably going to KO you. It probably is. But that's why, you know, you add that one to the data bank. So right now, don't have much. Knight d4 takes back. It's one idea. Knight takes g4 is, of course, an idea as well. But we'll try this. You know, we'll try it. Okay, we'll take that back. Knight g5. So it's threatened a checkmate in one. So I actually don't have many moves here. I don't have a single move that stops it. Let's start with that. And the only other thing I can do is try to move my king somewhere to that square. So I've actually only got like one move. Only really got one move here. And it's going to be f4. So let's witness the destruction. f4. How do you prevent the bishop sack? Well, we're going to definitely analyze the game after. So maybe I can try to answer the question then. I got destroyed instead of helping you. Well, we're going to get destroyed in the game and then we're going to analyze after. Well, knight g2 is going to lose more material, right? You guys play knight there. There's going to be knight check. There's going to be queen check. You're going to have to lose a knight and you're going to still lose the rook. So this move seemingly loses less material. Seemingly. But our opponent's putting us in the dirt here. Okay, queen takes. I mean, he's attacking our knight, so I have to put one of these knights here. Simply must. See what he has in store for me. Okay, we got to move our king. Hey, we survived. Well, that was fun. That was fun. Great game. Now I can actually play it. That was a good time. Winnable. Okay, let's pre-move that. That looks like a safe pre-move. Okay, so he played this, which means, I mean, I guess I'm probably going to take it. Queen takes g2. Just getting put in the shed by this guy. Just getting ragdolled. Let's defend. Oh, spare me. Just spare me. Absolutely, yeah. We definitely got taken out back. So like I said, we were going to look at the bishop h3 tactic. So we lost the game, so we're going to look at it anyway. But yeah, let's take a look. I feel like we didn't even play that bad. Well, the report's gonna tell me. Yeah, 41.4. But a lot of times when your opponent has a high accuracy, you end up having a lower one. Especially in crushes like this. So let's take a look. It was that tactic that basically downhill from there. So let's have a look. First of all, opening can't be too unhappy with, right? This is pretty normal. H3 is good. We want to stop that. So I would say in a position like this, probably as soon as you have the option to play d4 in one of these openings, I would say it's good to go for. Like d4, if everybody takes here, something like this, you know, you'd be happy with this. This would be a good outcome. Okay, queen's in the middle and it's pretty safe, right? If our opponent gets tempted trying to attack us, we just move back and, you know, the rooks have very easy, easy central squares to access. So I would say d4 is a good idea. So we played queen d2. We played bishop there. Again, I think d4 could be played over and over and over. All these moves. I think it could still, you know, lots of moves here. Knight d5 would be a good one. I just brought the rook to the middle, basically completing our, you know, our normal setup. And he played bishop takes h3. And like I said, the reason it's so strong is just he has a simple attack here. I take it, it's undefending my knight. Now, when you guys are saying that you're scared of bishop sacrifices there, I'm guessing that most of the time the black queen is here, and it's a sacrifice where the queen ends up on h3. Because this is a very atypical sacrifice. This is not how it's normally done. Usually the queen is backing up the bishop, and they sacrifice together. Like the bishop sacrifices, then the queen follows up. That's more common. This one is not really a sacrifice, it's just a tactic. It's just a tactic. So I would say with the queen behind it, that's usually what you guys see. If you're very scared of that, you can always bring your king to that square right there and guard it. And you know what? If the king was on this square, this tactic wouldn't work here either. So king h2 is one way, if you guys are afraid of these bishop sacks, to defend it. Right, king h2 is comfortable. We would also stop the tactic here. But the other thing, obviously, is just to be aware of it, right? To know, you know, the queen and bishop, they line up like this. With the queen here, what you have to do is whenever there's a sacrifice, we've talked about this. So let me just go here. We've talked about how to handle this. And what I've always said is that as soon as they sacrifice here, let's say 9 times out of 10, the best defensive move that you can play immediately after is this one. It's always going to be the case, right? Knight to h2 as soon as they sack. Number one, your knight's probably going to be hanging. Number two, you want to make a, you know, safe place for your king to hide. And taking control of that square means that there's going to be no checks. And this is always the case after, whether it's a sacrifice here, here. So just we've talked about this in the habits before, but a useful defensive move, knight h2 after a sack, is usually very good. So there's a few ways to stop that, but in the game, obviously, queen f6 is played, and this is less of a sacrifice, more of a tactic. It's just a tactic, right? And like I said, knight h4 would be the move, but g6, and here, definitely moving the knight instead of putting the queen in a pin. But he played very well. Here, he should probably do, I don't know. I guess he could do something like knight g5 and knight d4, some combo of that. Knight g5, bishop takes, and then knight d4. I think that would be maybe the best way to proceed. The main takeaway from this game is that as soon as I can play a move like d4, I think I'm going to play it. GME short sell, you're asking me if I can play gambits? Look at the screen, buddy. No gambits. No gambits. All right, let's see if he's going to be a London player. No, he's going to be a Queen's Gambit player now. We have an opening for this. We said we were just going to play this and get castled. Okay, he's going to take. Bishop there. Okay. So remember, our setup is usually pawn here, bishop there, this bishop out to one of those squares, knight d7, castling. That's our setup. So we're going to play c6 here. Okay, getting castled quickly. Oh, he goes e4. Okay, very aggressive. Very aggressive. Usually when our queen gets attacked in the opening, I tend to go all the way back just to safety. Okay. He decides to trade. And let's get castled quick. Bishop g4, so don't think I'm doing anything too strange. So far all looks normal. All looks normal. Knight d7. Where are my rooks gonna go? Well, I think the answer is easy this time. Open e-file, and I'm attacking a pawn with rook to d8. See what he wants to do here. Knight d7 is probably my next move. Queen d3 looks reasonable. Let's go here. Rook here, rook here. That's the plan. And also, you know, this knight getting f6 is a very, very good square, I would say. So that's probably something we want to do in general. He goes knight here. We got to move the queen. Some reasonable squares. I would say this, 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 this. I generally don't like this because of rookie one. The rook's going to face the queen. I feel like I'm going to have to move it again. So I think I'm going to go. I think I'm going to go somewhere else. I don't like the idea in general having queens on open files. Queens on open files are never that good because they just get attacked by rooks. Rooks on open files are A+. A+. So we're going to avoid that. Queen F4, just I don't know, too far forward, not a square we use that often. I'm going to try just use a safer square. So I'm just going to go to C7. Keep our queen tucked away, protected. Again, there's lots of moves, so, you know, people suggesting moves. Not like if I don't play the move you're thinking of, it's bad. But I'm just trying to pick moves that have pretty easy explanations for the moment. But I like this because it just looks like it's tucked away. You know, it's sheltered. It's not going to be attacked by a rook, for example. And we can just focus on the rest of our pieces. So there we go. We got this rook out. Okay, F3, and remember this is maybe harder to remember, but we want to trade pieces. Why? Because there's an isolated pawn. That's like a reason we want to trade the isolated pawn. IQP, exactly. The IQP. So, I mean, that's probably why I'm trading pieces, but I also think Bishop E6 is a reasonable move, period. Okay, we got the two rooks in the middle. He goes here. I think we'll just go for the trade. Okay, and I'd like to play this move, but we don't wanna allow double isolated pawns for sure. What's the other thing that we say to do in positions like this? Occupy the square in front of the pawn. So the rooks are both now open. I want to put my knight in front of the pawn. You don't want to get tempted by moves like knight e5 in general. Like, they might be good, but unless you have a destination after knight e5, unless you have a plan after knight e5 about what you're going to do, I wouldn't just play it to play it. You know what I mean? You could play knight e5 and it's fancy, you got your pin there, but after the queen moves, where's your knight going? Right? You have to think ahead. My opponent is not thinking ahead at all. That's why I say your rating will definitely improve if you work on not hanging pieces. Rip. Was that a mouse slip? I do not believe so. E3. Definitely don't think I've seen this one before. E3. My guy's playing my guy likes the French so much, he's playing it with white as well. So, what have we talked about? In the center, generally, we don't want to close the position. And if possible, we want to maintain the tension. Thing is here, we're not really playing an opening we've seen before. And knight c6 allows d5, which is definitely not something that looks very normal or good at all. So I'm probably going to take the pawn because at least it does open the position. What I'm against is the move e4. E4 closes things up. Not looking for a closed position. Let's go here. Thanks for the gifted sub, Echo Echo. Okay, on there. Well, let's focus on castling. Okay. Number one thing, I know we always do this move, but if you ever have an open line to your opponent's king, you close your eyes and you always, always give that check. Always, always, always. It's just worth it. It's not a big deal, but it's always worth it to do it. Sometimes they'll have a very simple response like this, but sometimes they won't have a piece to put in front of the king, and it's very, very annoying. So this is just a move you definitely, definitely do. Pawn is actually hanging here, so I'm going to defend it. It's our normal setup. I'm going to play h6 next, now that our pawn's protected. Okay, this bishop wants to develop next. Where's it going to go? Well, it's probably going to go here. And you know what? If I didn't play this rook move, what would have happened? He might have brought his bishop to that square and then castled. And his bishop would be a lot better placed on that square because it would stop me from going here. So because of this rook check, I actually have this square available. You know, the rook check doesn't look like a big deal, but it causes him to go bishop here. I think it's a good thing. And now, now he goes here. He wants to go for a trade. That's fine. That's fine. Let's finish the development. My knight obviously doesn't want to go to the side of the board, so we're going to bring it into the middle. Definitely whistle cube. I mean, there's a reason why I'm trying to get you guys to avoid. And let's bring the queen here. So I have my knight watching over this. Where am I going to put my queen? Well, in fact, I was on this square last game, right? I said it's a nice sheltered square. Out of the way, connects the rooks. Yeah, there's a reason I don't have you guys playing closed positions. It's not the type of chess you want to learn when you're just starting out. You want open positions, you want tactics. Gotta learn that stuff first. Okay, rook there. I suppose we take. And why is that? Because this other rook can't take back. So it means that next move I get to go here, and now I have the open file, even if it's just temporary. Okay, right there. Of course, there's this move trapping the bishop, but once again, we don't dabble in moves like that. First of all, it does look very scary anyway. I'm not sure I would even play it in a real game, but g5, g4, those are moves we're not touching. Not touching. Okay, so pretty much done everything. I mean, you know, we've got all our pieces out. We've got a rook on the open file. Pieces developed. We've got h6 in. Okay. Now is where, you know, a knight jump in the middle makes some sense. I'm personally just going to throw some random pawns up first. Okay. He goes knight here. Don't think he has a threat, but his bishop attacking this knight. Imagine my knight wasn't there. He would be threatening something like knight takes h6. Exact same tactic that we just looked at. And then he would win my knight for free. So that's just an example of what I would be thinking of. Okay, I'm just going to continue my pawn shove here. Probably this one next. Random pawn moves. OP. Queen attacked. Have to move. So I already mentioned I'm not a fan of queen on open file in general. Rooks do well there, not queens. So if I'm not going here, and I can't go to any of those squares, then I only really have two to choose from, right? Can't go here either. So it's here or it's here. I would say queen to b4 looks a little bit more aggressive, actually has a threat. So I'm going to choose that one. He did just move his knight four times. Just to take my bishop. He goes a3 and he actually doesn't address the threat of queen takes b2. So I'll take it. What moves are coming up for me? Well, knight e4 is looking very good. Not only have I, you know, won a pawn over here, but knight e4, knight in the middle of the board. A knight jump like that in the center is always going to be good. Now, why am I going to take this rook immediately without thinking? Because I just won a pawn. I have one extra pawn right now. This move threatens to do more trades. Trades are good. I'm up a pawn. So I'm just going to be looking for trades at all times now. This is a good trade for me. I get his bishop and he gets nothing. So whenever you're up material, look for trades. Okay. Knight back in the middle of the board. Good value right there, right? Oh, look at him. He's giving me a trade. He's giving me a trade. You don't have to tell me twice, buddy. You don't have to tell me twice. I was going to try to force that as well. Okay, another trade, even if it's pawns. Trades are good. Trades are good. We're not going to say no. Okay, so he's threatening this. If I play this, he can take this pawn. So it's just about which pawn I want to save. I don't think I can... the only guy can protect it. Unless I do this. I think I might do this. Might be the most logical. I was going to say, I can't protect it with my queen. So I'll use my knight for the moment. What's my next move probably going to be? I think it's going to be queen here. Like I said, I'm going to try to keep it simple and just go for trades. Go for trades. The other thing I've said in the end game, when you have a pass pawn, close your eyes, push it. Close your eyes and push it. So this is a pass pawn right here. I'm going to get my knight out of the way. I'm going to put this pawn there. Put that queen there. And just queen behind pawn here. And push it. That's my main goal here. All right. We're going to push. We're going to push. Okay. And he blocks it. We're going to have to get the queen out of the way. How do we get the queen out of the way? Let's attack it. Knight here. Knight e2. Oh, is that a trade for me? Is that a trade for me? Obviously, I'm going to take a trade. And it's, I mean, yeah, taking a trade and I just pre-move the pawn. That's not very difficult. He happened to walk into checkmate, but he was in trouble there anyway. He was in trouble there anyway. That's just him. He walked into that. He traded the pieces. He did that all for me. He made it himself, literally. E4, E5. What about if you're down material? I mean, this might surprise you, but you're going to do the opposite of what you do when you're up material. Bishop here. I want to stop knight g5, so I'm going to go bishop c5. Okay, now the knight can develop. We want to go like this. And we have talked about the fact that when they play pawn here, that we do want to play pawn there to prevent that move. Before we castle. There we go. Okay, every time this trade is proposed, we take a step back. We want him to take us to open up our rook, pawn closer to the middle of the board. We don't want to take him and do the same thing for him. Pawn takes closer to the middle of the board. Okay, queen there. Interesting move. Might be a habits, bro. I'm going to put a bishop here and probably piss him off, to be honest. Why is he going to be pissed off here? Well, he might move his queen back, honestly, or he's going to play his knight to the side of the board. Why are knights on the side of the board not good? Hopefully, we can uncork something that we've done before. We've done before. So this is actually not going to be a brand new tactic for us. Hopefully, it's something that we are accessing in our memory bank a little bit. Well, knights on the side of the board are bad because they don't attack any for sure. They have less... you know, small range of motion. But it's also a square that's often vulnerable. Like, for example, the queen from her starting square is always attacking this. Always attacking this. So knight takes e4. Might look like an advanced tactic, but we've done something like this before. Knight takes e4, queen takes h4 is the idea, just uncovering the attack. That's why knight here is always a little suspicious. he's having a good think here, but he does just need to take this knight back. Yeah, and then we'll take our piece over here. That was why we did that. Okay, he's trading pieces after he lost material. We love to see it. We love to see it. Okay, queen e3. Let's make sure to do that thing that we need to do. That thing, that important thing. Castling. Let's go. Let's go. I would have probably taken with the pawn on e4, yeah. Okay, so he attacks our bishop. Guess where my bishop's going? It's going to a square where I can offer him a trade. Of course it is. I'm up a pawn. Trades are the answer, and he's going to oblige. Thank you very much. We can finish development, you know, bring that rook closer to the middle of the board here. Trades. Trades. That's all we want to do. So what are some other moves? I mean, I want to finish development, so I am probably going to bring this rook over, but what are some other moves that offer trades that I might consider here? Because those are going to be the ones you want to start thinking of. Mr. Blunderful says Queen G5. Username checks out. Rook there. So the funny thing about this, which I actually will play this move, I am going to take his pawn. Just because it showcases why opening this this file is actually so strong. Right? It's actually because of this. So my guy just totally forgot about it, brought his rook to the middle. And I took his pawn, and then he brought his rook back. So just to rub it in his face, I'm going to bring my rook all the way back. Thanks, bud. Just a quick in and out. So I did see some queen f4s from a lot of you guys, which I'm a fan of. So I'm going to follow you guys. That is offering a queen trade. We want to offer queen trade. Not only are we up the one pawn from earlier, we're up this pawn now as well. I mean, look at this, my lucky day. Rook trade. And now let's see if he plays a good move here. I'm going to offer another trade. Right? So what would be a very good move by him? Rook here. It's on an open file. Right? Keeps pieces on the board. What would be a very bad move by him? What he just did. You should never be trading just, you know, voluntarily when you can keep pieces on the board. Okay? So we're getting our king to the middle of the board. We're gaining space in the center. More trades. And if the knights can ever trade, this should be game over. My king is getting closer to the middle. So I'd like to trade these knights. And I think personally, knight end games are pretty much some of the toughest end games in chess because it's hard to have rules. In a bishop end game, I can give you a lot of rules, like put your pawns on the same color as his bishop or the opposite color. You know, there's some easy things to follow. Honestly, in knight end games, there are no rules. It's like a cage match, like anything goes. It's very difficult to explain. It just takes a lot of intuition, a lot of practice. There's no rules for knight end games. It's like, hey, put all your pawns here. Well, the knight can just, you know, bounce around and attack it. It doesn't matter. You'll never escape a knight. Knights can touch every square on the board. So I'm gonna try to follow my end game principles of attack opponent's pawns and activate king. So that's all I'm going to try to do. I do have extra pawns, so I feel like I should push them. Use the king a lot. Attack opponent's pawns. Okay. Not only are trades very good, right? But I'm going to use my king and attack opponent's pawns. So let's attack that. Okay, let's attack that. Okay, let's attack that. See, this is fun. Okay, it goes here. Let's move this knight somewhere. Maybe we attack that. Okay, let's attack that. So am I playing this end game very well. I don't think so, but you know, let's attack that. But you see the idea. You're not gonna be making too many blunders if you do this. Okay, so I think we've established if I move my knight here and here, he's gonna move his knight there and there. We need to do a bit better than that. Trades, always gonna be good. And of course, we're approaching the magic golden rule of endgames. When you have a passed pawn, push it. So once this happens, that's a passed pawn. That's gonna be my main focus. I'm just gonna be pushing that thing. Now, of course, I could build this up a bit better. Maybe I would have played c5 to keep these pawns together. But trust me, at this level, like I think all you need to do is at some point just push pawns. Just push pawns. Okay, let's. How do I support? Right now, I'm being stopped. How do I support this? How do I push this pawn forward? I need to like move my knight around. Okay, let's attack pawn. Let's say. Wow, that must have been a damn good move. Whew. Sheesh. K-O. Hopefully that was at least remotely instructive. Honestly, and I mean this seriously, knight end games are one of the trickiest in chess. Even for me, at my usual level, very, very tricky. It's tough to drum up, you know, exact rules for endgames, but luckily in this one we were up so much material, two pawns, that we were the favorite to win anyway, but they're actually very tricky. Attack pawns, push past pawns, king to the middle. I mean, we sort of just follow the basics here. Nothing too special. All right, let's get another game. Oh, this guy's also going for 1500. We got to stop him. Whoa, Asan Khan, what is this rando spam? Oof, that's gotta be, that's a sub using his spam privilege. And just type in the word spam? No, we have to display remote, you know, double digit IQ at, you know, while we're spamming. We can't be in the single digits. All right, Sicilian. We're gonna go knight f3. What's our plan? We've played it every time. What's our move? We're always going to play this opening. We're always going to do it. It's given us some good wins. Let's see if we can get someone with the PFT. Oh, G6. Okay, well, we're going to go D4. Now, after this, I mean, every bone in my body wants to play this move and then that move, even though those are terrible moves just for the PFT. But that's bad habits, guys. You shouldn't play chess like that. Don't do that. Right there, let's develop. Bring our bishop out. You know, we can actually bring our bishop here as well, but I think defending this pawn, supporting the center is a little bit more valuable in this case. Knight there. So this is exactly where I would bring out this move. This is where I would bring out this move. H3, big fan of stopping bishop there. He goes queen there. Let's castle quickly. We're hoping, you know, just hoping he's gonna take that. Of course he is. He's 1499. This guy's never gonna see 1500 playing moves like that. Mahmoudi. Whew. I was hoping he was listening. I think I convinced him that the move was bad. You know what I mean? He was like, wait a minute, I guess I lose my queen. Because after bishop b5 check, he has knight d7 and his queen's protected. But shh, don't tell him. All right, he took there in the center. Let's take back. All right, so we just won a piece out of that. I don't know how we did it, but we did win a piece. All I know is I've got three of them and he's got two of them. All I know is I got three and he's got two. Now, after bishop takes, we do want to complete our development, right? Let's say queen. We want to go for trades. So I'm going to go something like queen here, followed by bishop there. Just trying to go for trades. I'm going to keep it nice and simple. Nice and simple. There are lots of ways to go for the win here, but like I said, I'm going to keep it real simple. Hopefully, it's easy to execute for you guys as well. Okay, so I'm going to offer a queen trade. Queen takes b2. No worries. No worries. Rook b1. No worries. He takes my pawn, but generally, guys, pawn grabbing when the king is still in the middle, got to be very, very careful. So I'm going to go ahead and take his pawn there. Oh, he's coming with a quick move. Rook c8, but that's actually very helpful for me. I wanted to move this anyway. Right? Knight into the center of the board. It was being attacked there. I think there's probably a 50-50 chance he just doesn't even see this. But queen takes a2 is what I expect from him. So queen takes a2, our turn. What are we going to do here? I think what we're going to do is we're going to set a great, great trap for our opponent. Now, a lot of you guys might be tempted. You know, hey, bishop here, right? Bishop here, uncovering the queen, going for checkmate on e7. But after you play both of those moves, don't forget your opponent can take your knight. You're not actually going to be going for checkmate. You guys are going to be hanging a piece. Be very careful. Be very careful. So what are we actually going to go for? Outhash me. No, bishop. No, 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 no. Careful, careful. Guys, we got a lot of people hanging knights in the chat right now. Got a lot of people hanging knights in the chat right now. Be careful, guys. Bishop f3 is a reasonable move. Makes a mate threat. Okay. Rook a7. Good move. Hey, knight f6. Good move. But we're going to play the lotto. We're going to play the lottery with queen to d4. Damn it. Wanted a checkmate in two. Habits. Rook e1. Just pieces in the middle. Hey, you know, I've even got my h3 move in. So I got all my habits on point here. Pieces in the middle. Got rook there. And you know what? This king, it's not castling in either direction. It's not castling in either direction. There's going to be a lot of tactics working here. I think almost every move that is legal is good. Almost every move. But I'm going to go for a very, very controlled approach. Very controlled approach. Right? Rook's in the middle. Oh, queen trade. Yes, please. Yes, please. You don't have to tell me twice. You don't have to tell me twice. Rook takes. I think it's time. I think it's time. We're going to take this pawn. We're going to go nice and simple. Nice and simple. This game, we're going no frills. No frills. A lot of winning tactics, but we're going no frills for this one. Okay, he goes here. Rook a8. Reasonable. Oh, a free piece. Oh, a free rook. We'll take that. He's attacking my knight. Got to move that guy. How about a fork? Winning a pawn. Attacking my bishop. Again, we're going to go nice and easy here. Just move the bishop back. No problem. No problem. Okay, he's attacking my rook. We got to move that thing. Let's go somewhere, attack a pawn maybe, go here. Okay, got my knight, got to activate my rook. How about we go for a trade? Offer a trade to my friend here. Let's go here, attacking the rook. Let's save that thing. Now that we are indeed near the end of the game. I mean, we just want to use the pieces. Let's bring the king to the middle. It's always a good habit. But as soon as we get a pass pawn here, we're just going to be winning the game. So something like this. If I take this pawn, I'm going to have a pass pawn here. Let's try that. Here we go. Okay. I'm going to have to start reacting with this king. Let's go here. Let's push that pawn. Push that pawn. Should always be the simplest way to win. Just get a pass pawn and push it. Okay, let's push it. I'm going to pre-move it. Okay, I'm going to push it. Okay, let's use the ladder. Wait a minute. Oh. This is not an effective ladder. Let's take that. Look how slow he's moving, though. Let's take that as well. Oh. You know, I was flustered. My ladder didn't work. You know, look. I was flustered. I stand by the ladder, but what I should be doing is going like this. I should be going this way. That would be an easy win, a quick win, right? And the reason that this one works and not the other one is because there's too many things in the way. There's pawns, king, bishop, there's so many things in the way, right? So what needs to happen is this. This would be the correct way to do it. Queen h7. Go that way. However, making that decision split second, not easy. However, if you're not sure how to mate or you're panicking, please take those pawns. You don't take those pawns, it's gonna be even worse. You're gonna lose the game. You're definitely not gonna be having fun. So If you're ever panicking, you're not able to get that checkmate in, just take everything from him. At least the worst that can happen is a draw. I definitely didn't try to stalemate him, by the way. I thought he was going to go king a1. So it's definitely intentional. Definitely not intentional. But you know what's funny about this stalemate that happened? Look at my last move. It's not even necessary. This would also be stalemate. It's kind of funny. It's not like this move helped at all. He's already in stalemate. It's just, there's like no acceptable move with the rook there. It would have to be a check. That's the only way. Any check would be mate, but yeah. This was not intentional. I thought he was playing king there. And then I was going to go here and like try to bring the rook down there. Okay. Here we go. Now, he plays a good move because there's no PFT available. Jeffrey, thank you for the 5 subs. Good to see Jeffrey back in business. We had some, we had a time last night, didn't we? Right? There's no PFT here. The king's not, there's no check. So I would just be hanging a pawn. Right? I'd just be hanging a pawn. Can't just give up a pawn for nothing. So let's continue. Knight g4. Interesting. Well, our whole point of the position is to play d4. So we're going to go here. That's right, Jeffrey. You know, you can't have absences. So after this move, I think it's actually kind of an important moment because I think the best move here is definitely like this. But you know what? The position is going to be very close. So I stand by what I've mentioned earlier, which is that you always want to open the position, especially at the level we're at. Open it up. It's going to lead to more tactical positions, period. So even though we don't get to, I'm going to go knight c3. Even though we don't get to force this knight to go here and maybe double his pawns after h3, I much prefer to see en passant because position starts to open up. Okay, so he goes here. Okay, we can kick the knight out. He's going to go back to the center though. Obviously not ideal. And we're going to play d5. Why are we playing d5? I've talked about it before, but this is a move we want to get used to playing. Just pushing this knight around is going to be a good thing. Okay. He goes knight to b4. We're going to rip open the position. Exactly. Getting the hang of it. So, knight there. Attacking the pawn. I can defend it. I can also play bishop check. So let's go for bishop check. It's a little bit more aggressive. It helps us get castled with tempo. With tempo. Notice how he cannot castle in one move. So we're going to try to play very, very quick. Quick, quick, quick. With tempo, take, check. Okay, he takes this way. Let's castle. Now that we're castled ahead of him, I know it's only one move. We do have some time here to make moves of our own. A bit more aggressive than our opponent. Number one, I can think of a3. Looks pretty decent. Another one would be like knight moves attacking the queen. And then, you know, just our regular good developing moves like bringing the rooks to the middle. So I'm going to go for a3. That's exactly what we did to this knight. The knight's going to have to go there, basically. Yeah. And let's just bring our pieces out. Okay. These pieces are coordinating an attack there. Okay. Let's bring our rook here next. Because you know what? We got one rook on the open file attacking his pawn. The other rook needs to be here defensively on that pawn. Okay. We'll go here. And I mean, look at our position. We got extra space thanks to this guy. I'm liking it. Thanks again, Jeffrey and Eviscerated for the 5 subs. Appreciate it, boys. Isolated pawn, though, you're 100% correct. You're 100% correct. We do have to be careful. It is an isolated pawn. However, you know, isolated pawns mean that we want to keep pieces on the board, right? If we're playing against the isolated pawn, you know, for our opponent, he wants to trade pieces. So we don't actually want to trade that many pieces here. We got to keep that in mind. We got to keep that in mind. Okay, so we don't want to trade pieces. What do we want to do? Let's make a threat. Exactly, hockey and things. There's no need for that. There's no need for that. Too many 800s are just trying to invent, you know, the coolest tactic they've ever seen. It's like, you know, calm down and just bring your rooks to the middle. Tyke. Calm down, little guy. Just get in your Fisher-Price scooter and, you know, just wheel yourself around. Okay, queen back. Let's continue to make threats against the queen. Okay, I don't think I can keep attacking that thing, at least definitely not playing a move like that. How can I keep threatening? You know, at this point, I'm just trying to make some threats. Trying to make some threats, right? Threat. B4, I agree, also a decent move. Queen e3. I like queen e3. Yep. Yep. I like queen e3. He's played a good move. Knight e4. So queen's under attack. And we have to pay attention. Queen has to guard the bishop on f4. So he's uncovered an attack here. The queen has to guard that. The queen is hanging. Oh, hang on. Houston, I think we have a problem. Wait just one second here. Queen e3. I mean, there's no way I can just lose my bishop for free. So I have to play this move. And this is going to be tough. After bishop e5, I might be leaning on the chat for some help here. I might be leaning on you guys. We'll see what he plays, though. We'll see what he plays. But I have a hanging knight here on e5. So, guys, someone help me out here. White to play. Ah, I see a lot of guys with f3. What's going to happen after f3? Well, who knows? You might win a knight back, but you might lose a pawn. You might save the knight. Guys, we can do it a little bit cleaner. A little bit cleaner. F3, good move. Queen takes c5. Better move. Exact same idea that you guys had. You guys all saw the knight was pinned, which is why you played f3. Queen takes c5, exact same thing. I'm using the pin just like you guys, but it's cleaner, right? I'm going to get this queen now. I still have my knight c7 threat. Okay, and depending what he does, I might actually win this knight as well. It depends. Are you the first one to say queen c5? I'm not sure. But they're definitely the minority. I saw a lot of f3s. Okay, so we're going to get a queen back. And look at that. We brought it right back to even. Right? To even terms. And he goes rook there. I mean, he's really tempting me here, boys. He's really tempting me. Knight takes pawn. How are you going to play a move like that? Let me take a pawn. Attack your rook at the same time. Not going to have me shying away from that. Okay, he goes back. You know what? I'm going to go back as well. I just wanted your pawn, dude. That's it. Just wanted your pawn. Okay, rook's being attacked. Now, let's get some pre-moves in. Knight here. Safe pre-move. Right? This is the point of the game where... Okay, how about doubling the rooks? Try that as a pre-move. Okay. Now, here, not sure what he's going to do. Okay, he defends that. Let's go defend our pawn. Now, let's get another pre-move in. Double the rooks here. I think these are all pretty safe pre-moves. Okay, he's going to double the rooks, I assume. Let's bring our king. E6. Honestly, very good move by him. Can't take it. Okay, but... when he takes, now he has an isolated pawn, let's blockade. Doesn't matter whether or not we win this game. Practice your pre-moves. King d3, this looks like a safe pre-move. Right? And how about after that? Let's get some more pre-moves in. Okay, look how slow he's playing every single move. Okay. Pre-move. 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 Right? Am I playing good moves? Not really. They're fast. Ah. Pre-move. 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 Oh, pre-move. Pre-move. You know, and at least we got him down 11 seconds. What did he start at? Did anyone see? You know, it was about a minute to 10 seconds, but... basically, if you're able to do stuff like that, and I don't think any of my pre-moves were very good, actually. If you're able to do stuff like that, think about when the guy's at 30 seconds. All of a sudden, you might win that game. The guy's at 20 seconds to 10 seconds, you should always win that game. Right? So it's just about practicing your pre-moves. Like, there are certain positions when you should pre-move, when you should not. You know, here, once I block this pawn, there's like maybe checks coming, so I'll pre-move king here. Why would I not pre-move king here? Because his knight could go there and stop my pre-move. So, it's just, look, I'm hanging pawns. It's not like this was a good pre-move, but it was a safe pre-move. It means I can do it quickly. Okay, without being worried about losing a piece or losing the whole game immediately. So, was able to get him from, you know, like a minute all the way down to 11 seconds. Like I said, a different time, you're going to be winning those games. So, let's have a look. He got us. That was a good one by him. He played a good game, 92.7, like I said. But nothing unreasonable by either side. Okay, so first of all, he played an actual good move against this opening. However, this is not it. He should be going knight d5. That's right, Natty. Okay, so here again, h3, probably the idea. But I want you guys to open the position, so I know it says it's a mistake, but... I'm a fan of E takes D6. I like this. This is how we want to play. Okay, so we get out of the opening. Fine, A3. Again, the reason that, you know, the engine's not really liking this is it wants more aggressive moves. But let's stick to the fundamentals. we need to. And you'll notice that when we stick to the fundamentals, yes, the evaluation might be like plus two, and then it goes down to like plus one or maybe to equal. But what you will notice is that most of these moves I'm playing, although it might give up some advantage, it never gives my opponent an advantage, right? So I might be missing moves, but you notice that eval bar, it's staying in, you know, the white side, or I guess black side of the board, staying in that territory the entire time. So it's about playing, you know, high percentage moves that are generally not going to mess the position up totally for you. You might miss a few wins here and there, and hey, this move, not the best. He has knight there, but you see that evaluation bar, it's hanging out, you know, and it's in the same territory the entire game. So yeah, this was just pretty much came down to time at the end. But he played a good game. I think our game was solid as well. Nothing to be concerned about in terms of, you know, usually what we do is we check the opening after. And if it completely crushed us, then, you know, we have to examine it and make sure it never happens again. But I think that this was still very good. Let's see what he plays. D4. Okay, we might see a London, actually. I'm in for a London. Who's in for a London? Like I said. So, whoever was just asking about the London, here you go. This is what we play. C5. You get to watch the answer to your question. That doesn't happen too often. Okay. Here we go. And he decided to take. So what are we going to try to do? We're going to try to take that pawn back, you know, right away. Okay. So let's go here. Interesting. I'm not going to do this. Generally, you don't want to open things up. Let them take your queen, your knight, or your king is going to have to move. So let's just go here. Let's just go here. Okay, he takes in the center of the board. We've been talking. There's a lot of ways to take this pawn back. Almost every time I do take this way. Why? I know it's an isolated pawn. You know, it might not be great, but white is going to have to play positionally against us. But when you have the isolated pawn, usually you're trying to do things a bit more tactically. Tactics are what we want. Okay, we want our positions full of tactics right now. Okay, let's get this bishop out here, sure. Could I have taken the bishop? Not quite. Isn't IQP a weakness? It definitely is, but, you know, it also gives me more space, control of the center, all these good things as well. Okay, it gives you a lot of good things as well. It's not like you get an isolated pawn, you're just worse. No, I mean, there's two sides to it, right? So white is going to have to try to convince me that it's a weakness. He's going to play in a certain way. And I'm going to try to convince him that it's actually strong for me. That supports the center, gives my knight some outposts. You know, there's a lot of good things about it as well. So playing with the isolated pawn, though, is, you know, it's a very difficult thing to do. Now, let's talk about this for a second. That's a pin, and we have talked about in the past trying to get our knight in or to double our opponent's pawns, which would be a very good thing. So technically the move knight e5, same idea as knight d4, which we've done a lot. I don't think knight e5 is crazy. I know it hangs a piece momentarily, like, you know, it's not protected, let's say, but we have the pin keeping us cozy. Okay, so we're gonna play knight e5. It looks a bit advanced, but, you know, I think that the reason we're doing it is it's fairly justified. Really justified. Now, this bishop on this diagonal, I'm going to be moving it back here. This is the, how do we call it? This is the attacking diagonal. This is where all the tactics come from. Rooks. Where should the rooks go? You know, probably I need a rook right here to support that. So I would say rook d8's a good start. And a rook on the open file is never bad. Okay, now, let's keep that pin, right? We're not just going to give it up for nothing. Whoa! Okay. That's a big, big move from my opponent. Very aggressive. Very aggressive, but very weakening. Look at his king. That's not what you want. Okay, bishop's getting attacked. Let's go back. So I think we should be very happy with this. Our opponent has a big weakness in front of his king. He is threatening our pawns, so we do have to be careful. I'm probably going to play a move like this, which does guard the pawn. But even if we lose this pawn, look at what, you know, I mean, he's committed like a war crime over here. Like G4 is very, very bad. So I'm going to start with this, just a defensive move. But our opponent is hopefully going to regret playing the move G4. Knight D4, another good move by my opponent. So I said I wanted rooks here. We could start, you know, put a rook on the open file. Knight F5. Okay. Knight F5, I think it'd be reasonable to take here. But at the same time, I do want to be slightly careful about trading too many pieces. So I'm going to make a move that keeps pieces on the board. I have the isolated pawn. I've talked about how we don't want to trade pieces. We don't have to. After F3, we have to, right? But I'd rather him play F3 and make me take it than just take it in one move. Okay, F3, bishop. Wish I could go to these squares. I can't. Bishop takes F5. Sucks, but we got to do it. We got to do it. It's a very active play by him. Absolutely. I think it's kind of funny because I'm the one who should be playing actively. He should be like playing against my pawn. Instead, look at all these pawns that moved in front of his king. It's wide open. It's wide open. So let's take a free pawn. We're going to be super greedy. Super greedy. That's why I put my bishop there last move. So, hey, let's go for it. You guys are wondering about queen d6? Definitely a good move, right? The rook still wants to go to d8. So I think I will probably play like queen d6, bishop d8. Aha. Bishop d5 by my opponent. Well, let me ask you guys. We're not taking with a knight. We know that. We're pinned. So what's the calculation after queen d5? Queen d5. Queen d5, knight d5. But bishop takes f6. This is where you would have to have this calculated. There's no way you just take that back. Queen's loose in the middle of the board. However, if I'm taking his queen on d1, there's no way that he can do something other than take it back, and then I can grab this bishop. We get an extra piece there. Thank you very much. And I get to take here. Now, of course, I'm taking with the bishop, not the pawn. We don't want to double the pawns there. So it's a tricky calculation. I think he played very well this game, actually. I think that I had to find some moves that were not entirely obvious. But now that we are here, what are we going to do? We're going to go for trades. We're going to go for trades. Okay. And we're going to play rook here because our opponent, of course, you know, he's going to be playing moves like that. He's that type of guy. Oh, he's just going to resign. Okay, well, if you guys ever play and your opponent has 19 seconds and you've got 2 minutes and 40 seconds, you should definitely play that game. Please, please play that game. That's why there's never resign written on the screen right there. But yeah, seriously, I thought he played very well. This was not a game that I think was very easy to mimic. But the one thing about the isolated pawn, try to avoid trades and don't worry if you lose the isolated pawn. It's not the end of the world. It will often be the case that it's so tough to defend it. So just don't get caught up like worrying about defending it at all costs. There are often going to be cases where they can take it for free. We're playing Yordi. Yordi is a buddy from our chat. Okay, let's see what he's got. So E4, E5, knight F3, knight C6, bishop there. We go for A6. Bishop back. I think we've done this before. Knight F6. Bishop C5. C3. C3. A very, very tricky move. I'm telling you guys, this is the bane of our existence. This move kills us every single time. This move destroys us. The Ruy Lopez is, I would say, not something we see as much as bishop c4. Like the Italian game, we see this very, very often. But the Ruiz, I think a little less common. A little less common. So, first of all, we have played a game in this series where it went here, here. I think it was maybe take, take, bishop here, and d5, and we just lose the knight. Just lose the knight. So that's happened to us before. Okay, so first thing is we're going to try to remember that and not let it happen again. I'm going to castle. Make sure to get out of this pin. B5. Yeah, B5 is a move, but it's not a move that you normally, that we normally ever play. We never play these moves like B5, G5, like so early, unless it's like a random pawn move. Then we might play it. Then we might play it. Okay, but normally we don't. So we're gonna walk right in. Okay, D4. Well, the problem is both of these are attacked. Kind of have to trade. Takes back. Bishop's got to move. We always go here when we're attacked. He goes rook to e1, and what am I doing? I am definitely 100,000 per million% going d5. There is no doubt in my mind. Hey, potent ponables. Habits, at least three hours or so, 2-3 hours, something like that. Potent. Good to see you, man. Knight gets attacked. Where we always move these pieces when we have this option. When we need to move it, we always go to the center where possible. It's the only central square, so I'm going to go here. When I say no gambits, does Queen's Gambit count? I have a question for you. Why wouldn't it count? No gambits is a fairly definitive statement. Okay, he goes here. Can definitely take that. I think I'm probably going to develop pieces and guard his threats at the same time. This looks solid. Oh my god. Boys, I think we're keeping the 17K for the moment. I think we're keeping it for the moment. I just got a good feeling after that. 100 gifted sub bomb by Potent Ponables. 100. I think 17K is safe for the moment. Who just got us up? Who just got us up? You know, there's so many gifted subs that people are getting subs. They're not even... Twitch is running out of people to get. I mean, they're not even in the stream. There we go. Potent Ponables, VIP badge. But it's for a reason. It's because he's coming in with support like that on the regular. On the regular. Unbelievable. Potent Ponables. Thank you, buddy. And he's really been enjoying the Habit series. So that's... I've been grateful for his support during that. Thank you to Potent Ponables. But I should be the only one saying thanks, guys. If anyone just got a sub, or if anyone just respects and appreciates that type of energy, give him a thank you in chat. That support makes me hard, says Procrastinator. That's the way to be, buddy. That's the way to be. All right, I'm just going to play h6. We need a move. This is never going to be... Never going to be a bad one. Thanks again, Potent. 100 gifted subs. I mean, I was just talking, Potent, about how we're doing this Habit stream. If you're tuned in for later, we have a $2,000 match between two of our viewers, Valentinian and Prem. This will be around midnight Eastern time. So that's something to tune into. Okay, let's get the queen up and, rooks like that. But that's the schedule, Potent. We got late night stream coming. Habits first. 2-3 hours more. Sober or drunk? Well, you're talking about people playing the match? That's for $2,000. I would be sober if I was playing the match, but it's up to them. Okay, queen there is attacking this pawn, so I feel like this makes a lot of sense. Yeah, it's not for everyone, Potent. It's not for everyone. Yeah, rook to the middle, guarding the pawn makes a lot of sense. If he makes a sort of non-threatening move, I'll probably go rook here. Goes to the middle as well. Hey, I'm going to join you. Okay, knight there. So, knight there tells me a couple things. First of all, that this pawn is... Well, the pawn seems to be hanging in the middle. It would take a calculation here, but bishop takes, knight takes, pawn takes, and my rook guards the bishop. Guys, I've always been clear, pretty strict on this as well, that if your opponents are hanging central pawns, those must be taken. Those must be taken, especially once your king is castled and you're in the middle game. Be on the lookout for your opponent hanging central pawns. Those are very, very important pawns to take as soon as they're available. Hello to Kiss My Bishop. Hey, we missed you, bud. We missed you. Good to see you back. You may run into your buddy Valentinian tonight. Okay, G4. We don't like the look of that. Now, this is tempting to attack the queen, but I'm going to choose this square because it still defends my pawn. That's not a good looking move. That's not a good looking move. Tuck it in, you know it. Protect him. RV's got the right energy. Okay, so queen goes back. Now, I know this is, you know, a reasonable looking move, but it walks right into something you never want to do. So the funny thing is, if my opponent played queen here, right, you know, a move earlier, then e3 I'd have to think about because, you know, I lose a bishop. I also get this. It's a calculation. But what he did is he put my bishop on a square. It's protected. And then he played that. You know what I mean? He's helping me out here. You're already. So that's what another reason why g4 is just simply not a good move. I mean, he weakens his king, he puts my bishop on a safer square, and my bishop's doing the exact same thing from here as it was doing from there. So nothing changed about the position, only good things for me and bad things for him. Queen a4. Okay, well, let's get one thing out of the way, and that's pawn takes pawn with check, okay? And how many of you guys are going to have the restraint not to take this rook? Promote to a rook. Rook takes e1, and hopefully, I mean, hey, if you guys play queen takes, respect. You guys are going for the end game, but queen and getting involved over here. Checkmate in one. That's what we need to play. Queen takes queen, going for trades, winning the game that way. That's fine. But if you see queen to f3, that is a mate. That is a mate. So yeah, queen c2. Queen c2 definitely just lost him the game on the spot. Queen c2. But I would say the move g4, you know, the precursor was not much better. You know what I mean? G4 walked into it as well. Sort of set this up. Now, we have a chance to hit 2,500 with, not 2,500, 1,500 with this game. And I think with this rating, we can. Hang on a sec. Guys, I think we can hit 1,500 right here. This is a big game. Okay, any move that doesn't take the center, I always say just take the whole. Take the whole thing. Let's go. Can we do it? Gotta follow those habits, right? Knight f3, knight c3, bishop c4. I'm gonna be going for, you know, knights first, bishops after. Bishop c4, I think I'm gonna go for that. If you play bishop d3 or bishop c4, I think they're both very good. Now, we've been talking about keeping the tension, so I'm not gonna be taking that, I'm not gonna be pushing. I'm gonna try to leave these pawns here. Let's castle. h6. Okay, well, if I can't put my bishop there or there, you guys know where it's going. Knight e7. He's playing playing some interesting moves. Let's go queen d2. Whoa, g5. Guys, I'm concerned here. G5 is coming out from Buddy. And he's looking comfortable. He's looking like he's done this before. G5. Well, okay. Let's just play in the center. Now, when you see people do a lot of kingside stuff, generally what you want to do is open up the middle of the board. So I am going to be leaning towards, you know, pawn takes pawn a lot more. That's just, you know, that's just going to be the case. I want to stop him from attacking my knight, so I'm going to play h3. See if we can finish development and probably like take in the center. Okay, so let's start by taking the center. Just open things up. See if that helps. Okay, it didn't help. So what do we do now? How about a random pawn move? Oh, queen c8. Hey, guys, does anyone know what Buddy's doing over there? Anyone know what Buddy's threatening? Anyone know what he might be up to? I got a feeling what he might be up to here. Now, I'm gonna play pawn here. It's another random pawn move on this side of the board because we talked about this sacrifice. And I told you guys what my recommendation was to defense. Let's see. Let's see it in action. Who knows? All right. I said when the queen gets there, we're going to play knight h2. We're going to let it happen, and we're going to see how in trouble we are. Here we go. Knight h2. You thought the recommendation was king h2? No, king h2 is the recommendation to prevent this. If this happens, knight h2 is the recommendation after it's happened. Okay, now, knight f4. So, very clear threat from our opponent. What is it? It's checkmate in one. That's right. Ace checkmate in one. As soon as someone sacrifices like this, what you want to do ASAP is bring a lot of pieces to defense. Why are you scared? Good question. Let's bring this bishop. Put it right here. We're going to attack the queen and we're going to cover g2. You might say, dude, bishop's on such a great square. It's a backwards move. Yeah, but remember, we're about to win this game if we survive this attack, right? More pieces near my king, better defense. Always, always. Queen h5. Can someone tell me what my opponent is threatening? Sorry, let me rephrase that. Can someone tell me if my opponent is threatening? I mean, I think it's fair to say everyone in the chat was a little scared of this, especially after he set it up. I said, all right, let's see how scary it is. And how quickly are we now all agreeing that White's position is completely fine? Two moves later. Attacking chess, it's not like a hack. It's not like you just play attacking chess and just win the game. It's not free love. Okay? So, pieces near the king. We want to do trades. I'm going to put this thing right here. Okay? If he wants to take me, I mean, go ahead. I'm going to put as many pieces in front of my king as I can. Basically, I'm replacing the pawns that used to be there. Okay, bishop takes knight. Absolutely a move I want to consider. Absolutely. I assume he's going to develop this bishop. I mean, that would be nice. Okay, he decides to take. Well, I'm happy. G4. He's still attacking. Respect to him. How do we keep defending? Things to the king side. Even if you don't really know why you're doing it, just put things there. Boom. An extra piece. And what's going to happen now? Now I'm going to want to move my knight. I'm being checked. I have one move. But you can see what I want to do next, right? I've got this rook here. One thing you have to remember about defending in chess is you can keep like reminding yourself that even if something looks scary, there's probably a defense. Because guess what? If you look at an engine, is this going to be saying that black is completely winning? Of course it's not, right? Of course the engine is going to maybe have some decent evaluation. There's always, literally always, unless your position is so bad you're getting force mated, you're always going to have a defense. And sometimes it helps to know that when you're being attacked, that there is an answer, right? So when you're being attacked, you know, it can be scary to look at a position like this, your king's wide open. You're like, oh man, I'm getting mated here. I have nothing. I don't know what to do. But if you tell yourself, all right, I'm getting attacked, but there's an answer out there. Let me find it. It's almost like you're solving a tactic. Like, you know, dude, he's got one queen. I've got literally like five pieces around here. Are we scared of this? I mean, are we scared of this? This is your attack? You guys are scared? You're all petrified of this guy? This guy's scaring you? This guy's keeping you up at night? Let's go for some trades. This guy over here. He's the one we're afraid of. Let's get the queen in there. Oh, now we're the ones doing, you know, a little bit of attacking. Oh. My friend is starting to play very quickly. Very interesting. We are now the ones attacking. How did that happen? Wait a minute. So you guys are telling me that this guy over here, the guy who doesn't have a single goddamn piece left, we're afraid of him? No. I mean, this guy's attacking me? Look at this. This is a full mount. This is a full mount. 1.5K. That deserves a KO. K-O. It's helpful to know. When you're being attacked, there's always a way out. Even if the attack is good, right? It might favor him, but there's always a defense. It's never just like checkmate by force. Okay. Accuracy, never going to be the most accurate game, but let's have a look at move by move. I'm just curious like what the engine sort of evaluates the attack by. Definitely scary, but we gotta be able to defend in chess as well. It's a very important skill. So let's see. Move by move. He went for the sack. Okay, so first of all, it's a mistake. Let's start with that. Now, knight h2. So first of all, it's the best move. It's not because I calculated it was the best move. It's because I told you guys, whenever this sacrifice happens, pay attention to knight h2. It's often going to be your resource. Okay, he goes here. Another mistake. Okay? I went bishop here. I went bishop here. It's a mistake. And fair play. I was supposed to play the move, knight b5. Now, knight b5 is me attacking him back. It's hilarious. Within two moves of him attacking me, I play a move like this, and my opponent is almost lost. I'm threatening to checkmate him in two moves. And if he takes me, well, I'm threatening to use my bishops and my queen, my rooks, and checkmate him. So in just a couple moves, I can flip the entire game around and mate him. That's how bad his sacrifice was, right? So that's just to let you guys know, that's in the position. But okay, bishop g2, I think is a great move, right? We're playing in front of our king. The only reason that the computer says it's a bad move is I missed a better winning move, right? It's not like bishop g2 in itself is a mistake. He takes, I take back. He goes here. And again, this is not going to be, you know, not going to be a good move. Another mistake, right? But this is what I'm saying. It's, you don't necessarily have to play perfect moves. You know, what does the engine want me to play? a6. Right? Okay, a6. But simply bringing pieces towards the king, it's just always going to be a good idea. Never going to be a blunder. Okay, never going to be a blunder. Wait, looks like a blunder. Well, That's okay, guys. Look at our evaluation. It's a blunder because we're missing better moves, like A6. But again, the whole point of this habit series, is you don't always play the best move, but you always play a good move. Always play a reasonable move. That's the hope. Okay? Take, king F1. And again, look at the evaluation. Still in our favor. You guys are just naturally scared, and understandably so, naturally scared of being attacked. You know, it makes sense. However, look at this position. I have, like, you know, six pieces all around my king. There is one queen. One queen. How are you going to be scared of that? There's no way that's win. Like, it just doesn't make sense. No way that's just a win for black. There's no way. Queen F3. I'll tell you something else. There's no way that's the move either. Look how quickly it went from being petrified of bishop h3 to, oh, my opponent doesn't have a single piece left on the board. Hey guys, just a reminder that Building Habits is going to be a regular series on our YouTube channel, so make sure to get subscribed if you are not already. Drop a comment down below for the algorithm and let me know what you thought about the video. See you next time.